Good afternoon. I'd like to thank everybody for being here at CSIS today for what promises to be a very, very interesting discussion on a topic that's volatile and probably not getting quite enough attention. I'm Olga Olker. I'm director of the Russia and Eurasia program here at CSIS. If aliens land and anything goes terribly wrong, I'm also going to be the person to tell you what to do. But you know, you can see the exit signs and so forth. So the discussion today is on the North Caucasus, what's going on, what the implications are for Syria, what the implications of Syria might be. We are really thrilled to have with us Ekaterina Zakharianska, who's the project director for Europe and Central Asia at the International Crisis Group, where she's just put out a report on this topic, which I believe copies of are available for all of you. She has been working on these issues for her entire career. She's really one of the top specialists on the topic, and along with Ekaterina, we have Sufyan Zhimukov, who's another specialist on this topic, who is based at the George Washington University now. And he also has been studying Islam in the North Caucasus, nationalities, and problems in the region for his entire career. So I don't want to take their time. I want you to hear from them. Katya is going to make a few remarks based in part on her excellent report. Sufyan will respond, and then I think we can all have a conversation. So thank you again for being here, and I'd like to turn this over to Katya.
Thank you very much, Olga. Thank you, everybody, for coming. Was in DC for 6 years almost, I'm very happy to be back again. Well, for two decades, the North Caucasus has been among deadliest conflicts in Europe. It started as a separatist conflict in Chechnya in 94 and gradually transformed into a region-wide jihadi war. In 2007, then Chechen leader Doku Umarov, Chechen leader of the insurgency, declared the creation of the Caucasus Emirate, an organization which aimed to establish a Sharia-based Islamist state in the entire North Caucasus. And this organization was quickly declared a terrorist organization in Russia, US, and the EU. Since 2009, the epicenter of violence in the North Caucasus shifted from Chechnya to Dagestan, the neighboring republic, which became almost a full-blown war zone with clashes happening almost daily. And Dagestan, instead of Chechnya, became the main source of suicide bombers who attacked heaps of targets outside the region. Violence in the North Caucasus feeds on the memories of two very brutal wars in Chechnya and the subsequent heavy-handed counterinsurgency, unresolved intra-confessional and ethnic tensions, social inequality, corruption, failing social institutions, and a whole cluster of problems on which a crisis group extensively reported in its output in the reports and briefings that we have on our website. Also, the conflict has been fueled by some foreign ideological influences and a small number of foreign fighters who arrived and fought on the side of the insurgency. For 2 years in a row, though, we are seeing a remarkable reduction in violence in the North Caucasus. The numbers of casualties have been halved each year since 2014, which some experts attribute to the successes of the security services and some to the mass exodus of radicals from the North Caucasus to Syria. Official numbers estimate of 2,900 Russian citizens fighting in Syria and Iraq, but the actual numbers can be much higher. The Commonwealth of Independent States Anti-Terrorism Committee estimates around 5,000 Russian citizens fighting in the Middle East. Officially, around 900 of them are from Dagestan, around 500 are from Chechnya, over 130 from Kabardino-Balkaria, and some 30 from Ingushetia. These are the people whom security services could track name by name. Chechen security officials, though, acknowledge that the numbers are much higher, and they actually are unable to prevent the outflow that continues. On the 21st of June 2015, a joint statement of the insurgent commanders claimed that all Caucasus Emirates vilayats, or provinces, the administrative units of this organization, swore the allegiance to the Islamic State's leader, Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi. ISIS accepted North Caucasus, the allegiances of the North Caucasus commanders, and announced the creations of its new province, Vilayat Kafkas, the province of Caucasus. So which factors have motivated this ideological shift from the regional jihadist project to a global one, in a sense? First and foremost, this shift can be explained by the changed conditions for military jihad and peaceful Salafi Dawah proselytism in the North Caucasus. The second set of factors is related to the nature of appeal of ISIS propaganda to the radicals in the North Caucasus and the way it claims to be addressing the decades-old regional grievances and conflicts. So I will try to briefly go through these two main sets of factors. Starting from early 2014, jihadist groups in the North Caucasus were crashed and nonviolent Salafism was severely suppressed, which was a significant difference compared to the short period of liberalization which marked the second half of Dmitry Medvedev's presidency. At that time, the authorities in the region, but this was a process supported by the National Anti-Terrorism Committee in Moscow, tested new soft power methods. First in Dagestan, but also in Ingushetia, partly Kabardino-Balkaria and Karachay-Cherkessia, the law-abiding Salafi leaders were allowed to participate in public life, especially in Dagestan, to open mosques, praying houses, kindergartens, charities, some numerous projects and initiatives from picnics to a football, Salafi football league. They opened numerous educational establishments. A dialogue between Sufi and Salafi leaders in Dagestan was launched, which was aimed to overcome the strong intra-confessional schism, which is the basis of the current conflict. A special commission for rehabilitation of fighters was created under the auspices of presidents in Dagestan, Ingushetia, Kabardino-Balkaria, and Karachay-Cherkessia, which aimed to facilitate peaceful transit of people from militancy to the normal life, and it guaranteed that people would not be mistreated in this process, which was very important in the conditions of lacking trust on both sides. As a result, in 2012, the number of victims of conflict in Dagestan reduced by 15%, and much fewer people left and joined the insurgency. However, in the run-up to Sochi Olympics, which was supposed to take place in early 2014, a 50% reduction was not enough. Insurgency was still quite active. The areas of active insurgent activities were close to the place where the games were to take place, to Sochi. Moreover, the then leader of Caucasus Emirate, Doku Umarov, made a statement in which he called for his supporters to disrupt the Sochi Olympics with all means available. In other words, he promised terrorist acts, and some of them did take place, if you remember, before the Olympics. So security services now had to very quickly take under control all the potential risks, and they didn't have time for any evolutional processes anymore. So all soft measures have been rolled back. The Republic's Commission for Rehabilitation of Fighters were closed. Security services carried out hundreds of operations, making movement, logistic, communications extremely difficult, communications of the insurgency. They killed dozens of leaders and rank and file. They traced insurgents on mobiles. They followed their wives. They infiltrated the webs of accomplices and poisoned food that was going to the fighters into the forests. In parallel, they very strongly suppressed all non-violent Salafi activity. These Salafi projects were closed, most of them. They started to detain Salafi activists from mosques en masse, 40, 50, 80 people after Friday prayers, delivering them to police stations, keeping there, interrogating. They were harassing the most prominent leaders. Some of them were killed, some of them were jailed, arrested and jailed. As a result, the Caucasus Emirate was crushed, almost completely defeated. The insurgency became extremely cautious with any external communication. They suspected every new recruit to be a spy, and that's why everybody who wanted to join were put on an extended period of quarantine for a few months. So any communications and joining the insurgency in the North Caucasus has become very difficult physically. Further, the Caucasus Emirate lost its charisma because it was unable to disrupt the Sochi Olympics despite of the threats issued by Doku Umarov. We learned later that Umarov has been dead already a few months before the Sochi Olympics, poisoned in a special operation by the FSB. But this was announced only after the end of the Games in March 2014. The insurgency elected a new leader, Ali Ashab Kibekov, who was for the first time not a Chechen but a Dagestani. It was quite an important shift. And he was a radical cleric rather than a fighter, and he imposed very strict laws of jihad. First, he banned attacks on civilians and their property. He banned women's participation in jihad, and he also banned suicide bombing. And this alienated a significant part of the most radical and most criminal part of the insurgency. It also deprived insurgency of its main funding, because all the previous year, the insurgency had been funding itself through extortions, through extorting the so-called jihad money. What they did, they were sending the so-called memory sticks to businessmen or officials, and they demanded big sums of money. And people paid, because they indeed killed those who didn't pay. But now, first, it was banned by their leader, and secondly, they were too weakened to actually extort. In order to extort, you have to be strong. You have to be able to implement your threats, but this was no more possible. And ISIS propagandists were there, and they were mocking this North Caucasus insurgents, saying that while you are eating leaves in the parochial waters, backwaters of Dagestan, we are fighting in five-star jihad here. So many of those in the insurgency who could actually cross the borders and go, they went, and many radical people who were not in the insurgency also joined in hundreds. Mostly these were new recruits, because it was exactly as I mentioned, it was difficult to cross the border for those who were already wanted by the security services. And only few small groups in Kabardino-Balkaria and in Dagestan remained loyal to the Caucasus Emirate. It basically completely lost its agenda and its capacities. Not only insurgency, but many moderate Salafi leaders left as well. They had to flee, and many of them fled to Turkey. They were under acute pressure by security services. Their projects were mostly closed. So some of them were commuting between Turkey and Russia, and many moved there. ISIS sought strategically to recruit such people, and they managed to get at least three big celebrities from Dagestan, the previously nonviolent preachers with big support, with a great number of supporters, great social capital, who resettled to ISIS. It not only leaders, but also many families, Salafi conservative families, moved to Turkey in this time period as well. They settled, the exact number is unknown, it ranges from several thousand to tens of thousands. Most of them settled in or around Istanbul in conservative neighborhoods, where they form almost self-sustainable communities. They have their own teachers, their own taxi drivers, shops. So Turkish officials didn't bother these communities for a long time. And since November last year, when the Russian-Turkish relations dramatically deteriorated after a downing of the Russian plane by the Turkish military, Russia directly accuses Turkey of supporting the jihadists. Turkish authorities deny this, emphasizing that they have actually been left without international support for controlling the flow of transiting foreign fighters. Jihadi operatives did function, and they are continuing to function in Turkey. North Caucasus radicals who wanted to transit to Syria were usually met by the ISIS liaison people in Istanbul, in the airport. They would put them in transitional flats and then help them go to Gaziantep, where with the help of special Russian-speaking guides, they would cross the border. The important Caucasus Emirate ideologues also live and work are based in Turkey, including those who organize financial support and, again, transit of fighters, but not to ISIS, not to non-ISIS groups. 8 of them were killed in Turkey, assassinated. The Turkish authorities suspect the Russian security services to be behind these assassinations, but it's very hard for them to investigate because, as they say, the Russians use proxies. On Sunday, however, they arrested 2 Russian citizens on suspicion of the recent assassination. The change of the Turkish authorities towards the North Caucasus Salafis changed in December 2015 when a 18-year-old pregnant Dagestani woman blew herself up at a police station in Istanbul. Since then, the arrests have become quite systematic and preventive. Turkey also tightened, of course, the control of the border. However, the cooperation between Russia and Turkey has dramatically deteriorated in the recent months. People still go, and it's not possible to prevent this. Very, very difficult. In Syria, Dagestanis and Chechens are the dominant ethnic groups among the Russian-speaking jihadists. Most of North Caucasians fight in ISIS, but they also fight for the al-Nusra groups associated with al-Nusra Front, and in some independent groups, mostly under command of Chechens. These groups often fragment and merge. The commanders and fighters go from one group to another, but even when they are part of larger groups, North Caucasians tend to stay together. Many of them don't speak any languages apart from vernaculars and Russians, and they feel more comfortable in they feel isolated among Arab-speaking fighters. But recently we get news that in some of the groups commanded by Chechens, we have Syrians fighting, increasingly the Syrians and Arab fighters as well. North Caucasians and especially Chechens are treated with respect among the Syrian jihadists because there is a myth that they have been that they are very battle-hardened jihadists, that they've been fighting Russia for the last 20 years, which is of course a myth because most of these people have never had any combat experience. Most of them are just 20 plus years old. Many of them come from the diaspora and they have never had any previous battle experience, but this image helps them be quite quickly promoted to second, third rank positions in IS and also to commanders and amirs of the independent jihadi groups. The most highly positioned Chechen until recently in ISIS was Umar Shishani. And the reports say that he was killed in a US strike in March. According to some reports, he was just badly injured. His military achievement reportedly helped al-Baghdadi to declare Khalifat. He has an interesting close associate, a man called Abu Jihad, a young Karachai, a radical from Karachai Cherkessia, who was responsible for his propaganda efforts, and he is a kind of ideologue of Russian-speaking jihadists in ISIS. These two men, Umar Shishani and Abu Jihad, are thought to be responsible for the rebranding of the North Caucasus insurgency into the province of ISIS. Once Umar Shishani became Amir of the ISIS Northern Front, he and Abu Jihad reportedly tried to strengthen their position in ISIS to climb the ISIS hierarchy, and also they wanted to increase their popularity among Russian-speaking jihadists, so they sought to co-opt the North Caucasus insurgency. And by the end of 2014, when the Caucasus Emirate was already very weakened and losing its charisma, Abu Jihad sent messages to the commanders of North Caucasus insurgency on the ground, and he demanded, well, not even us, he demanded them to openly state declare their position towards the Islamic State. Silence was his response for a few months, but by July 2015, the rebranding was completed. One by one, the commanders swore allegiances, and then they made a group statement. Well, alongside with the crackdown on local militancy, the ideological shift in the North Caucasus is also explained, as I mentioned, by the nature of ISIS appeal to the radicals in the North Caucasus. Most of the Salafis I talked to in the North Caucasus say that the key reasons, the main motivation for people to join ISIS is religious motivation. Islamic State recruiters can convince, especially young people, that joining caliphate is their individual obligation, what is called in Islam fard ayn, something that you as an individual Muslim obliged to do, and if you don't do this, you fail your obligations to Allah. Before Russia criminalized the participation in armed formations abroad, which was in 2013, many people went to Syria to fight for 2-3 months and came back. They just fulfilled their obligation and returned, as one of my respondents said, that they went there as if they went to Hajj, kind of. They didn't plan to die, but just wanted to tick that they did it. But the caliphate is not only an obligation, it is also a dream. It offers a kind of utopia, highly romanticized dream of the revival of multi-ethnic Islamic entity that will eventually liberate and restore the dignity and power of Muslims around the world. And it really resonates in the Caucasus because many people think that we should go there, we should create a center of power there, and then come back and fight, continue our own cause. ISIS is also promises a new happy life, including for those who wish to create families and escape certain circumstances. And this resonates, for instance, in Chechnya, where many just want to find alternatives to the highly repressive regime, where it's increasingly impossible to live with any kind of dignity. Escapism is also a strong motivation for a less repressive Dagestan's context. As one Salafi in Istanbul explained to me, a Dagestani Salafi, people are looking for happiness, and ISIS will find a spouse for you. Even sexual satisfaction alone makes people happier, especially women from traditional societies, widows, women who were divorced or had traumatic relationships, or are trying to escape from their husbands that they don't love. ISIS is a project for youth, and we have to understand that, and that's why its propaganda and its appeal is targeted to young people. And very often, according to our observations, you will have a love story somewhere in the trajectories of these people. Unlike the weakened Caucasus Emirate crushed by Moscow, the Islamic State positions itself as a viable, feasible political project. The lifespan of an average jihadi in the North Caucasus is very short, 1-2 years maximum, sometimes several months. ISIS offers an alternative to what in the North Caucasus used to be a purely suicidal enterprise, and it also sets political goals in this lifetime. It positions itself as the most successful jihadi project of the 21st century, and success is something that almost all respondents quote as a very important motivation driver, especially for young people, as success is something very important. ISIS also attracts by its promise of effective Islamic governance and social order. It's a key factor in their propaganda. They, again, I will quote one of my respondents who said that they have eradicated gambling, smoking, prostitution, they pay salaries, the welfare, they have welfare support, the judicial system is working, the punishments are being implemented, and that's what many Muslims want. It also portrays itself as an egalitarian welfare project. In the North Caucasus, authoritarianism and clanship, inequality and lack of economic opportunities makes young people trapped in this predatory practices of the government, and there's a great number of disillusioned youth who cannot live a dignified life in their homeland. When you resettle to ISIS, it gives you flats, which they have captured from the infidels. They pay some small subsidies. Of course, nobody goes there for money. But the fact that resources are promised to be distributed fairly, according to the Islamic law, is an important kind of tool in propaganda. Actually, many people come with lots of money there. They bring all their savings. Some young people take all their parents' savings. We have stories when children of officials, regional officials, have taken everything from the father's safe and and went to ISIS to donate this money. And finally, another major ISIS motivation driver is its response to the perceived humiliation of Muslims in Russia and around the globe. Videos of atrocities committed allegedly by the Syrian army and the civilian victims of the Western and now then later Russian bombing campaigns are central to this. The photographs of mutilated bodies, dead bodies of children or injured, especially civilians, they have a huge psychological effect. People want to revenge, and the desire to revenge is enormous. As one of my respondents said, sometimes you feel that revenge is coming up to your throat and you can't breathe anymore. And the only way to restore your balance is to revenge. And they want to revenge effectively and theatrically, as one of my respondents said. And ISIS offers them this opportunity. Russian officials like to say that their experience of counterterrorism in the North Caucasus is the world's only successful story of de-radicalization. In reality, the current situation is reduction of violence as a result of the exodus, mass exodus of the fighters to Syria and of military defeat of the Caucasus emirate. Many sources in the North Caucasus believe that the Russian government or security services opened borders for jihadists who wanted to leave the country before the Sochi Olympics and even helped some of them out by this repressions, even though Russia criminalized participation in such armed groups abroad. However, since the second half of 2014, the policy has changed. Russia is really trying to prevent the outflow, and our sources say that every jihadist who reaches Syria is now seen as a personal failure of a local policeman, so they ask from the local police officer if somebody goes. Security services across the region now target recruiters, those who raise money for the jihadists. They quite effectively are cleaning internet from the jihadi propaganda. At the same time, unfortunately, after the Sochi Olympics, they have continued the campaign against the nonviolent Salafis. And they don't make a distinction between violent and nonviolent Salafis in the region at all. The key method of control is the so-called profuchot, which is preventive registration of extremists. Since second half of 2014, the numbers of people who were put on the special list of this profuchot has increased dramatically. Only in Dagestan, there are 15,000 people on the list. If you're on the list, you will be stopped at all traffic checkpoints, interrogated, taken to police station, again interrogated, fingerprinted, photographed, kept for a few hours, and this will repeat like very often. And human rights groups say that such people are the first targets of arbitrary arrests, torture, falsified criminal cases. The police is also kind of has not been ready for this new policy. They lack the manpower and time to follow all the prescribed procedures. Security services also continue to arrest believers from mosques, and massively 40, 50, 80 people after Friday prayers. They have closed several Salafi mosques in the recent year. They are also targeting the non-violent Salafi, moderate Salafi imams. Just last Friday, another Salafi imam was arrested from Hasavyurt. He was one of the few who openly spoke against ISIS during his sermons. This is very rare because ISIS is threatening these moderate leaders. They are much more dangerous for them than the security services or than Kadyrov, because they are playing on the same field in a way, and the moderates present a much greater danger for them. In Chechnya, policies against Salafis are even harsher. Ramzan Kadyrov directly says on the local TV that Salafism is banned in Chechnya, although it's not banned in Russia, that these people will not be allowed to live in Chechnya for a minute, and that should be killed. He says Prophet Muhammad told us to kill them. There's a small time lag in between, but between the emergence of Salafism and Prophet Muhammad, but these are details for him. The Chechen security services arrest Salafis, people who look like Salafis, and they detain them, and people disappear, so it's very brutal in Chechnya. These measures, of course, anger Salafi communities. They empower radicals. They closure of mosques decrease the security services' capacity to monitor these communities, because, of course, the mosques are packed with all kinds of bugs and agents, and it's much easier to monitor what's happening with these communities. Unlike when people are out of the mosques, they dissolve in their flats, and you have no understanding of what's going on. And this, of course, weakens the moderate forces. The outflow to ISIS continues, and the security challenge remains serious. The North Caucasus jihadists have become global actors. They have quite important roles, some of them in ISIS and in non-ISIS jihadi groups. And they try and will continue to try to keep Russia high on the agenda of these organizations. They have repeatedly issued threats to Russia and to its leaders. ISIS has taken responsibility for a number of attacks in the North Caucasus, as well as for the death of 224 Russian passengers of the Russian plane, which was coming from Egypt. North Caucasus fighters in ISIS very closely monitor everything that happens in their republics. For example, when there was a conflict, one of the mosques was closed in Makhachkala, ISIS immediately made a statement. And they appealed to the angered young people, saying that dissolve. Don't listen to your moderate leaders who are trying to negotiate with the Russian authorities. Go home, dissolve in the crowd, and hit when they don't expect, as your brothers in Paris did. Every time something happens, they put out a statement like this, inciting youth to terrorism. They repeat this propagandist to repeat that they will come back the moment the circumstances permit, and they will continue their war against Russia. Of course, ISIS is a global challenge, and Russia, as well as the West and international community, need to develop de-radicalization strategies and pool intellectual resources from various fields across disciplines, including experts on the regions, open-minded security officials, educators, and moderate religious leaders. Ultra-radical ideologies thrive on unresolved grievances and conflicts regionally, globally, and locally. That's why we need to invest seriously, intellectually, diplomatically, financially, in conflict prevention and conflict resolution. This will save us lives and very significant military expenditures. Thank you.
Thank you. Oops. Thank you, Katya. Sufyan, do you want to, however you prefer?
Well, thank you for the great presentation and for the great report. The North Caucasus insurgency and its involvement in Syria is a very complicated issue, and it's not an issue where you could easily find what's the problem and how to deal with it. And that's one side of it, and because it is the problem of radical Islamism, but also it is a problem of Russian state, this post-Soviet legacies in Russia and increasing authoritarianism of the current regime. From another point of view, it's a very dividing issue, and because of that is very emotional issue. And this report actually amazingly deals with both problems. It's not, this is like perfect analysis, absolutely probably free of emotions, which explores researches on both problems, on the problem of radical Islamism and on the problem of how the current Russian regime deals wrong, absolutely has unsound methods in dealing with this really important problem of our time. In order to understand the roots of the problem of the North Caucasus, probably we need to address both categories of roots of the problem. From one side, we need to understand the North Caucasus And usually it is seen mostly through the prism of Chechnya and now Dagestan as a spillover of terrorism from one of the places in Chechnya or in Dagestan where it emerges. That's probably one of the misconceptions how we see the Caucasus. This report doesn't have that misconception, but I would like to point out this thing that the Caucasus is not, though we say it's a region, in fact, we should regard it as a divided region, divided into East and West. And that would help us understand the whole problem and address it more easily. So in the East, we have three republics, Chechnya, Dagestan, and Ingushetia. In the West, we have other three republics, Kabardino-Balkaria, Karachay-Cherkessia, and North Ossetia. Also, this East and West are divided in terms of Islamic schools. In the East, in these three regions, we have Shafi, more stricter school of Islam, dominating, while in the West, we have a more milder Islamic school, Hanafi. And that emerged since 19th century, and the approach to Islam is somewhat different, though it's not opposite. Though there are two schools, doesn't mean that they conflict with each other, but they have their own their impacts on the issues as well. Also, in the report, very, very well covered this problem of new diaspora. And when we talk about North Caucasus diaspora, we should also distinguish the old diaspora that exited from Russia in 19th century after the Russian Caucasus War. That's the old diaspora, and to the time there was no terrorism or insurgency or joining to jihad in Syria in the old diaspora, while this report very clearly shows that those movements are very popular in the new diaspora. And the new diaspora is mostly comes from the east of the Caucasus, not from the west of the Caucasus. And all the cases that are covered in this report about new diaspora being involved in jihad in Syria, all the cases are from the east. Another very important issue is that in the East, in Dagestan, Chechnya, and Ingushetia, Islam becomes, after the fall of Soviet Union, increasingly became part of identity. So when you say, I'm Chechen, or I'm Ingush, or any nationality from Dagestan, you can also say, I'm a Muslim. While in the West, that's not the case. The ethnicities in the West, they are mixed Christians and Muslims. So for example, if you say I'm Ossetian, you can't say I'm Christian. Ossetians are Christians or Ossetians are Muslims because the minority of Ossetians, about 14%, are Muslims and the majority are Christians. The same with Circassians. The majority of Circassians are Muslims, and the minority Mozdok Circassians are Christians. So you claiming, developing your identity in the West as Muslim identity would be the same as like cutting off your finger because it's not part of you. And would be a very painful process for the identity building. So, that's always also distinguishes the West of the North Caucasus, Russia's North Caucasus, from the East, and explains to us many these tendencies that radicalize Islam in the East and radicalize it less in the West. Also, that's kind of the conceptual vision of Islam in the North Caucasus that can become one of the like theoretical basis to investigate in the roots of the problem. Another thing that we need to address when we analyze the problems in the region is post-Soviet legacies. And they are very, very complicated, and they are, you can't separate them from the problems like radicalization problems of Islam. So the radical Islam has the same effect on insurgency as post-Soviet legacies have. So analyzing post-Soviet legacies is also very important. And here, for example, we have this legacy of Stalin's time as deportations of four ethnicities from the Caucasus. So two of them are Chechens and Ingush, live in the East, and they are highly involved in insurgency, nationalism insurgency in 19th, and now radical insurgencies in the 2000s. And also, these deportation grievances during Stalin's time, they didn't end. So two other ethnicities, Balkars and Karachais, more or less they the authorities addressed their problems, paid compensations, recognized the problem. While in Chechnya, for example, Chechens were deported on February 23rd, 1944. And in 2014, February 23rd, the day of deportation of Chechens, coincided with the closing ceremony of Sochi Olympics. So in order not to spoil the picture of the ceremony, the Kremlin and the local authorities, Kadyrov, they decided just to cancel altogether the day of grievances. And the Chechen authorities dismantled the memorial for erected for deportation of Chechens, and it's not there since then, and they repressed several people who protested against it. And that's absolutely not the way to address this problem. And the people that were deported in 1944, some of them are still alive, and many people, their descendants of those who were deported, they this is a living memory for them. Another problem, post-Soviet legacy, is the way that Soviets, first Bolsheviks, of course, but later also Soviet authorities, dealt with Islam in the North Caucasus, and it was absolutely brutal. And what we had, what we have now is post-atheism Islam, very ignorant. And because of the vacuum that was created because of the Bolshevik and later Soviet strategies in the North Caucasus, Salafism was able to fill this vacuum that appeared during Soviet time in Islam, in the North Caucasus. And for example, there is this very important example of it in the report, when you ask one of the brothers whose brother went to Syria, and he answered, "They went to Syria as if it were the Hajj." So it is such a misconception of Islam. The jihad, any kind of jihad, even like spiritual jihad or like jihad as a militant operation, it's not in the five pillars of Islam. Hajj is one of the five pillars of Islam. So even comparing a pillar of Islam to some absolutely different concept, so these people who think that way, they misunderstand the very, very basics of Islamic religion. So, and it shows how the lack of religious education among them. One of the, I participated recently in a project about researching how the Hajj, this participation in mass rituals, increases tolerance in the North Caucasus. Our research showed that participation in mass religions opening to other aspects, to other communities, religious communities inside of Islam, increases tolerance in the North Caucasus. And we know the examples of those kinds of examples in other parts of the world, including the United States, when this black separatist movement led by Elijah Muhammad claimed that Elijah was a prophet, and his predecessor, Farc Wallace, was Allah, and they claimed that it was the proof that Allah was actually racially black. But then when Malcolm X and after him Elijah Muhammad himself and Elijah's son, they performed Hajj for the first time, they came back, and when they were exposed to the global Islam, they absolutely denounced this ridiculous theories about Farc Wallace being Allah or Elijah Muhammad being prophet. And the movement, thanks to this to participation of many of the members of the movement in Hajj and other mass religion rituals, the movement became absolutely legitimate. And in about 15 years, the head of the movement, Elijah Muhammad's son, was able to meet with the President of the United States, Jimmy Carter, and they became absolutely nonviolent and tolerant. So these misconceptions, this isolation, these post-Soviet legacies of atheistic approach to Islam, they play a very, very important role in radicalizing. And in conclusion, I would address another moment in the report, this very important decrease in terrorism activities after the Sochi Olympics. I'm participating in another project about Sochi Olympics, and we are analyzing the impact of Sochi Olympics security issues of Sochi Olympics, and when we look at the statistics of anti-terrorist operations and terrorist acts in the North Caucasus after Russia's invasion in Ukraine, we see very, very significant decrease. And it is, of course, kind of questionable, and it is very under-researched issue. If so, this report, for example, deals with two expert analysis of the issue. Some experts claim that this decrease took place because of the successful anti-terrorist security operation of Russian special forces. Others think, and now like more and more Russians claim, though before they never did, during Sochi Olympics or before Sochi Olympics, Russian authorities never said that, but now they say that they let deliberately these insurgents leave Russia before Sochi Olympics, and that was an issue that the tactic that contributed to decrease of the violence in the North Caucasus. But also, I think another issue that this report doesn't address, and actually it's not researched well in the academic community yet. Another issue is this coincidence of this decrease in violence in the North Caucasus with Russian invasion in Ukraine, which is absolutely illogical, because you would think that if Russian forces, security forces, military forces, they were more involved in Ukraine and less involved in the North Caucasus, you would expect the increase of the violence in the Caucasus instead of the decrease. So these issues need to be addressed, and maybe actually the report, this report addresses it in one way, saying that there was more dialogues in Dagestan between Salafi and classical, traditional Islamic authorities. And probably that was partly because of this lift of tension, of mistreatment of the Russian security services over the local communities. And if since that happened once, this kind of less involvement of the security services and oppression helped to decrease the terrorist threats in the region, maybe Russian authorities should try a more variative approach to resolve this problem, and try to rely less on the repressive methods and more on the methods including the civil society and engage in dialogue between Salafi and other leaders of Islam in the North Caucasus.
So thanks. We have just about half an hour for discussion. I'm going to begin by taking my moderator's prerogative and throwing a bit of question back at you. I think something that Sufyan closed with, which is Russian government responses. And I want to drill into that specifically with the people who are returning from Syria, whether we've seen any evidence of what the policy is towards them. Is there an effort to keep them out? Is there an effort to arrest them because they've been doing something illegal? Do the Russian security services have enough information to go after these people or not? And what you think will happen, and also what happened if there's been any if there have been any repercussions for their families also that you've seen, because we do know that Russia, like some other countries, has used that sort of punishment. Thank you.
People are returning. In quite significant numbers. They were returning before 2013. As I mentioned, some just went for 2 or 3 months and came back. In 2013, Russia amended its criminal code and introduced punishment for participation in illegal armed groups abroad, which contradicts the interests of the Russian Federation. So if you fight in Ukraine, that's okay. If you fight in Syria, that's a problem. And in 2014, they have increased sentences for this abuse up to 10 years. So everybody who wants to come back now, they are facing with up to 10 years in jail. These sentences are pretty indiscriminate because it's very difficult to carry out investigations since the events are happening in another state and in a war zone. Some people are known for committing atrocities, but this is a very rare case. It's some of the North Caucasians, basically had themselves filmed when cutting throats, for example. But again, these are just individual cases. In most of the cases, the authorities don't know exactly in which group these people were, whether they were in IS or in al-Nusra or in the groups that are not considered terrorist organizations in Russia. Also, there are some women. Actually, women have joined quite massively IS. Many of them are very disillusioned very quickly. When their husbands are being killed, they really want to get back. This is the moment when all of them are trying to get back home. It's next to impossible to get out of ISIS for women, as we know. Actually, it's generally very difficult because ISIS takes your passport immediately when you come in. But for women, it's also very hard because they are much more controlled there, and also children that are brought to ISIS belong to the caliphate since the moment when they cross the border. So if you want to go, you can even try to escape, but you can't take your children out. But women do try to get out. They're contacting people in Russia, there are some regional actors who help to mediate with the Russian authorities. And when they come back, they face basically the same charges. We are saying that it's very important to create safe exit programs for such returning jihadists. Most of these people are disillusioned. So many of them stayed there briefly and came back. Some women followed their husbands. Maybe they should face, probably they should face punishment for joining terrorist organization. However, they should also go a rehabilitation process. And those of them who are ready to contribute to counter-propaganda should be rewarded with softer punishments, we think, because nothing is comparable with the power of the emotional message for de-radicalization than the stories of these disillusioned jihadists. And Chechen authorities have a good practice. They used one of such returning jihadi named Majayev, who stayed for a few months in a non-ISIS group and came back. He was sentenced to 9 months in prison, and then he was taken everywhere around Chechnya. He was participating in various roundtables and speaking on television. And actually, sincerely, you can always see when a person is forced, you know, beaten and then forced to speak, or when he speaks sincerely. He had a very sincere account of why he thought this was all non-Islamic practice. It had nothing to do with religion, why you shouldn't go there. This really has a very powerful effect. So we think that this is a very important area. Yes, Russia, as most of the countries, prefers to just close these people up. And the sentences are long now, up to 10 years. This crime used to be like from 6 months to 3 years. Now it's up to 10 years. And this opens a whole new dynamic in prisons themselves. Because when you're there in jail for 2 years, all you think about is just to sit there quietly and to get out as soon as possible and hope, you know, to be released earlier for good behavior. But if you're there for 10 years, you start building up your networks, you start strengthening your position, and this Islam, a radical Islam, is one of the key tools for establishing a power center in jails. So radicalization in jails is a big problem. The government has already realized it, but their solution is, in a very Russian style, to close them in solitary confinement, which is not a solution, as we understand.
This policy of toward returnees is one of the instruments that the international community could deal with this very important threat. And Russia could actually play one of the key roles in that, because not only because many people return to Russia, but also because of this Russian-Syrian cooperation. Russia could cooperate with the Syrian authorities, probably the only part that could do that. investigate these methods of recruiting, the how this everything. So this could be actually one of the instruments to learn what Islamic State is from inside. In another country that could do it would be Turkey, and they are doing it actually, and they have bigger progress than Russia, because many people return from ISIS to Turkey as well. However, unfortunately, in Russia we have these debates inside of the law enforcement community. When law enforcement methods become more and more repressive, the regime tightens up, there are new laws, new methods and of investigation that more and more resemble NKVD than like 21st century comprehensive investigation methods. This recent establishment of National Guard which has clearly the purpose of repressing the civil society, and involvement of Kadyrov and his guard in that National Guard on federal level, when these practices of repression of civil society very hard in Chechnya, now imported on the federal level. So all this all these tendencies leave us very pessimistic that Russia could actually use this instrument of using the people who returns from Syria from ISIS against this terrorism. And another issue that Ekaterina mentioned is radicalization, and it is very well covered in the report as well. Radicalization in the jails. When we look at the tendencies in the Caucasus, we can see that criminal authorities are like squeezed between law enforcement and radical Islamists. And little by little, they have to join one of the sides. They have to go under the protection of law enforcement and corrupt law enforcement agencies, or they have to join insurgents and also become part of insurgency, and also, of course, corrupt the insurgency from more idealistic to more criminal way. But now we can see that happens also in jails, because joining the brotherhood in jail is one of the ways not only to survive but also to thrive in jail, because criminals are less consolidated than radicalized Islamists in jail. And so this is another issue that maybe not tomorrow but in 10 years can explode in Russia very, very unexpectedly.
Thank you very much. Do we have any questions? Okay, in the back.
Katya, thank you very much. It was a very impressive presentation, as always, coming from you. My question is, I'm not sure if you heard,
but... please identify yourself.
I'm Fatima Thuisova from Voice of America. Today, Patrushev announced in Tashkent that the next meeting of Shanghai Security Group is going to be in Grozny, in Chechnya, in May. Why do you think they're bringing the Shanghai Group heads to Grozny, and what role Russia or Kremlin may have in mind in the future for Ramzan Kadyrov and his forces? The topic of this, on the top of the agenda of this meeting, they say is going to be terrorism in Afghanistan and Central Asia.
think we'll collect maybe three questions and then go to the group. Jeff?
Thanks. Jeff Mankoff with CSIS. Katya, you mentioned briefly how moderate clerics find themselves targeted by ISIS and the insurgency, but I was wondering if both of you could address the role that non-radical Islam plays, both as a tool of state policy and just in terms of the response to the rise of ISIS and other forms of radical Islam in the North Caucasus.
And let's take one more here.
Michael Cesari, Foreign Policy Research Institute. I have a question about the potential overlap in recruitment among people who are being targeted for recruitment for ISIS or other Islamist irregular forces versus some of these irregular battalions that are these North Caucasus irregular battalions in Ukraine that are fighting for pro-Kiev forces. I mean, to what extent are these people drawn from the same pools of people, how does ideology play into that that decision? Thank you.
Katsa, do you want to go first?
Fatima, to your question regarding Grozny as the location of the next meeting of the Shanghai Security Group. Well, Grozny has hosted a great number of international foreign conferences and generally is being promoted, not only promotes itself, but is being promoted by the presidential administration as one of the important places for events related to Islam, to terrorism, counterterrorism in Russia. And generally, this means support to Kadyrov in his current shattered situation and support to Grozny as an important place for such events. This is one layer of explanation from my side. Second, there have been until Sochi Olympics, two main models of counterinsurgency in the North Caucasus. One, which I described we can call it as Dagestan's model, the one that tested the soft approaches based on dialogue, commissions for rehabilitation of fighters, more liberal attitudes towards non-violent Salafis. And the other has always been the Chechen model, so to speak, which is complete ban on any Salafism, very rough prosecution of non-violent, any forms of non-violent Islamism, very heavy-handed methods of counterinsurgency, targeting relatives, accomplices, generally no talking force. So since the lead up to Sochi Olympics, and basically since Vladimir Putin got back to office in 2012, the Dagestani model was sacrificed or rolled back in favor of the Chechen model. There's only one model now, the Chechen model, else everywhere in North Caucasus. Dagestan clearly follows the same track. It's just that it can't do it as fast because there haven't been two brutal wars in Dagestan and it has a much more sizable Salafi community than in Chechnya. They can't do it in one day. So, but gradually they're moving in the same direction. So basically Kadyrov's approaches, Kadyrov's model to counterinsurgency as seen as the correct and efficient ones. And this is the experience that they would like to transfer within the framework of the Shanghai organization. I would say these main two. Moderate clerics, and the role of non-radical Islam, and you mean more traditional Islam, right? This Sufi Islam in countering IS. Have I understood your question correctly? So, just for those who don't know the details, especially in the east, in the east of North Caucasus, the Islamic community is divided into the majority of the so-called traditional Muslims. Most people don't like this term, but we still use it, which is Sufi Islam, and the smaller minority of fundamentalists, mostly Salafis. The differences are both dogmatic and political. At the dogmatic level, Sufis is a more soft, mystical strand in Islam, which has integrated lots of ethnic traditions, and they follow their sheikhs or leaders, whom some of them, especially in Chechnya and Ingushetia, treat as saints. Salafis are strongly critical of any intermediaries between Allah and a believer. They think that veneration of saints violates the main principle of Islam, the oneness of God. They also speak against the lavish rituals and some other non-Islamic ethnic elements in the Sufi practices. The political level, the Sufis have de facto, traditional Muslims have de facto accepted the secular state, and they are ready to keep the religion to the sphere of private life. While fundamentalists, they want more Islam in all spheres of life, in political, in economic, and they don't ask now for Islamist principles in politics, but nonetheless, this is seen as a goal. And there has been a deep schism between the Sufis and Salafis since the 1990s, in which the state took the position of the Sufis and prosecuted Salafis. How can, now back to your question, how can the non-radical traditional Muslims influence the outflow or ideologically combat ISIS? At the general prevention level, so when they generally appeal to the society and they preach the non-violent, more traditional Islam, they are effective. When it comes to the already Salafi youth, they are totally useless. They can't speak to them. They will not listen to them. For them, these people are out, for many of them, they're out of Islam. There are differences, there are disagreements. Some of the Salafis, the Asharites, they think that Sufis are in Islam. Others even don't consider them the real Muslims. So they're just deaf and blind to whatever is being said by the traditional clerics, who are really trying their best. You know, they're tirelessly repeating different arguments against ISIS and jihad. But the only people who can effectively work with this type of youth are the moderate, non-violent, law-abiding Salafis. And I have seen examples of this. I quoted in the report, one of senior Salafis I know from Dagestan, he told me a story how a family brought to him a young man who was planning to go to ISIS. And he kind of failed everything at work, and he was not very successful in his life. He didn't know much about Islam. He didn't have a good education, but he decided to go. So the Salafi leader was speaking to him from the position of Salafi religion. And he said, what is the main principle of Islam? Oneness of God. Do you agree with this? Yes. Well, you are going to go and join some kind of strange caliph whom nobody of these Islamic scholars recognize as a legitimate caliph. And he's going to go to tell you, go and cut somebody's throat. And you will go and you will cut. How are you going to explain this to Allah? How could you put an intermediary between yourself and Allah? And in the name of this intermediary, go and kill somebody. It's better for you to be killed yourself than to do something like this. And the youth didn't go. He didn't tell him it's very bad to kill people, to cut throats. You know, he just used a different type of argumentation that worked. And recruitment to Ukraine and to Syria, it's a very interesting question. This is ideologically totally different type of agency. Most of these people, of course, who are fighting in Ukraine came from diasporas. And we see very interesting processes in the Chechen diasporas in Europe, I think, which are related with this experience. Ichkeria, which is the separatist project in Chechnya, was considered to be, well, if not dead, then dormant for many years, because it kind of lost its charisma. Some of the Ichkerian leaders joined Kadyrov, and Kadyrov was really trying to overtake many of their slogans. And some of them joined really radical Islamist groups, went to ISIS or to other non-ISIS groups in Syria. But even before, they took ideologically this more radical Islamist position. Ukraine helped the Ichkeria to be reborn and revived. These people who were for the middle way, who were oriented towards independent, secular or moderately Islamic Chechnya, they distinguished themselves from the mass and they joined the fight in Ukraine. And this Ukrainian experience helped strengthen the positions of Ichkeria in the diaspora. The blender of Ukrainian nationalism with Chechen nationalism gave a second life to this project, and we can clearly see how I don't know if you have seen, the Chechen diaspora organized a number of protests in Europe in January, and they were all under Ichkerian flags. And these were all young people. This is not the old generation of the Ichkerian leaders. This is the new generation who is taking up these ideas. And I think this is a very interesting phenomenon.
I totally agree with Ekaterina about this Shanghai Security Conference. The intention of it holding in Chechnya has only one intention. Actually, it is to legitimize, like on international scale, this what Ekaterina called Chechen model. And unfortunately, we see there are supporters of this model. More and more in political establishment, even in the West. We remember when the Boston Marathon bombing happened, the former mayor of New York, he said, "Now I understand Putin, how it was hard for him to deal with Chechen insurgency." And recently, one of the candidates from Republicans, I won't say his name, you all know, but he claimed that we should target also the relatives of insurgents. And this tactic was used in Chechnya for many, many years. So this legitimization of Chechen model, it is quite dangerous. But probably it may have some positive impact when the international community will be exposed to this language of this like Chechen model. Maybe the international community will learn more about it and have a better understanding and evaluate it better. This difference between non-radical Islam and sympathizers with ISIS, Ekaterina put it very well. There is this difference between traditional Islam and Salafi in the Caucasus. It based on completely different roots, and because the traditional Islam has roots not only in Islam but also in the local customs. The followers of traditional Islam, they respect their elders, they respect, they use not only Islamic rhetorics, but also centuries old customs that are very strong in the Caucasus, while Salafis, there are many examples when they denounce the local traditions, and they are more under influence on this this ideology that didn't have roots in the Caucasus. However, even here we may have in the future we may see a positive thing, because these insurgency movements, they are mainly movements among young people. Now Salafi groups, the first generation of Salafi groups, they are older, they advanced in their life, have families, careers, it's a more diverse group. It's not just a group that challenges this post-Soviet reality, but also partly accepted it. So maybe there is a way that this, in time, this Salafi movement will integrate in the local community and will help to de-radicalize the region. As for this Ukraine and Syria overlap, as Ekaterina said, the people from new diaspora are more have more tendencies to go to Syria, And it is like people who, like labor migrants from North Caucasus to Siberia, or labor migrants from Central Asia to Russia, they are more mobile, and they the statistics show that most of the people who join ISIS from Russia are these migrants. But at the same time, when we look at this new diaspora, Chechens particularly, who fought in Ukraine, it's completely different. It's not migrant diaspora. This movement based on nationalism. So people who fought in Ukraine, they are not radical Islamists, and they are very unlikely in mass to join ISIS in Syria. On the ideological scale, this Chechen diaspora in Europe had clashes with Islamic radicalization in the North Caucasus several times. First time it happened when Ichkeria transformed to Caucasus Emirate, that is, under Doku Umarov, changed the separatist platform to Islamic platform in the Caucasus. And even inside the movement, several people, two particularly deputies of Doku Umarov, rebelled. And of course, the separatist Chechen diaspora in Europe absolutely denounced Caucasus Emirates, never supported it. And also the leader of Chechen diaspora, Zakayev, who has asylum in United Kingdom, he absolutely doesn't support radical Islamic movement. So these are very different ideological movements.
Thank you. Yes, please.
Alex,
and I think this is going to be our last question. So.
Thank you. Alex Malikishvili, IHS. I have two questions for you, Katerina. I was wondering to hear your thoughts on the recent assassination of the Lezgin leader in Dagestan. And the second one, it was not quite clear for me the ICG's position on the Russian security services facilitating the outflow of militants and radicalized individuals from North Caucasus to Syria and in Iraq. You mentioned it, but it was not quite clear what is the ICG's position on this, given the extensive investigative journalism, including the publication of materials in Novaya Gazeta last year about evidence pointing to the facilitation of the outflow from North Caucasus. I'm referring to one investigative report in particular that focuses on Khasavyurt district. Thank you very much. This is Nazim Gajiev. Thank you very much.
No, because we're almost at our time, so that's going to be our last question.
I don't have any insider's information on this murder at the moment, so I wouldn't like to comment on this. But as to ICG position on outflow, well, we don't have a position on this, but we, in the report, we quote these investigations and people on the ground, who many of whom consider that this was a policy. Some of them disagree, but then we quote also one source in security services who said to the question that whether or not there was such a policy, who says very bluntly, of course there was. We opened the borders, we helped them all out, we closed the borders, and now we're bombing them in Latakia and Idlib. Everybody is happy, he said. They are dying on the way to Allah, and we have no terrorist acts here. I don't know if I've answered your question.
Sufyan, do you have anything to add?
Yeah, this statement by Russian security as if they planned somehow this outflow of jihadists from the North Caucasus to Syria, it is like doesn't have much ground. They don't support it by any evidence. It looks like they just claimed it afterwards. The same way as Kadyrov said that, as if he sent 500 spies for Chechen Spetsnaz to Syria. These are ungrounded just statements. Maybe someday they will produce some evidences of it, but so far, no evidences.
Thank you. Do either of you have any final thoughts that you want the audience to walk away with? Any final kind of thoughts to wrap up?
Yeah, I actually would, if somebody didn't read this report, I would just advertise as some, I don't have anything to do with it, but it covers so well, and if you need it just to educate yourself about it, it is beautiful. It implies several very, very important methods, and the language is very good. And I'll take a liberty and quote one sentence or a couple of sentences that I like. This interview of a Dagestani migrant in Istanbul. It's like maybe future writer or poet. So he said, "As a wave, we all floated out of Russia, and all of a sudden, the Syrian story turned our people into global players. They didn't even realize this. They had not been prepared for this. But with our Dagestani village mentality, they entered into big global processes." So there are people in the diaspora who can so comprehensively analyze the situation and see it from inside. And this report is based on many, many testimonies of those. And I would encourage you to read it very carefully.
Thank you. Katja, any final thoughts?
Oh, thank you very much, Pian. Thanks, everybody, for coming. And we're here to make unintelligible things more clear. We will continue our reporting, so stay with Crisis Group.
Thank you very much. Please join me in thanking our panelists.